خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين. صدق الله العظيم. Brother Chairman, respected Imam, brothers and sisters here at Masjid Darul Ihsan in Subang Jaya in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Before we address or attempt to address the subject of Madinatun Nabi fi akhir al-zaman, or the city of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in the last age, allow me to welcome some of my students who have traveled from long distances to be with us here tonight. I cannot mention their names, of course, for security reasons. We have a family who have come from France, a husband and wife and a daughter and a little baby, and we love the baby. And we have another student who's also come from France, but originally from Africa. And we have a student from England. And we have one who was born in India, now resident in the Arab Gulf. We won't mention the name of the country. And who traveled and came day before yesterday, insisting he wants to take the Shahada with us. And he took the Shahada last night and took the name of Yaqub. He's sitting somewhere. So before you leave, do please, there is Yaqub. Do please meet your brother in Islam, Yaqub, and embrace him. Make dua that Allah may preserve him in Islam, that his faith might constantly increase. He came into Islam, he said, because of his understanding of this subject, that Islam is explaining the world today. Our subject is entitled Madinatun Nabi fi akhir zaman, or in English, Medina returns to center stage. Medina returns to center stage in Akhirul Zaman. And this lecture is already written out. And it is very small, so there is no excuse. And Haji Radwan has also translated it into Bahasa. And we have it published on its outside in Bahasa. So you have no excuse for not reading it. The city of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, the city that he went to when he made hijrah. And we live in a world today in which so many are making hijrah, and so many more want to make hijrah. And they're increasingly looking to Malaysia as a land to which they should make hijrah. So that is to the credit of the Malay people for the kind of Islam that they have preserved, the Malay people. Of course, there are others also who are Muslims in this land. They are Indian Muslims, they are Chinese Muslims, and this is not to diminish the importance of what they have contributed. But the Malay people, mashallah, they have preserved Islam. And that's why so many want to make hijrah to this country. The city of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, where he sleeps in his grave at this time. And akhirul zaman. What is akhirul zaman? It is the last age. History will not continue endlessly. There is an end to history in which truth will triumph over all rivals. And that end of history must come first, before the world can end. When will the world end? We don't know. That's not our business. Only Allah knows. But when will history end? Oh yes, we do know. Because Allah's Messenger gave us many, many, many signs by which we can recognize that we are living in the last age. Amongst them is this sign that you will find tall buildings. If you have not seen the tall buildings as yet, I suggest you take a taxi to KLCC, Kuala Lumpur City Center, and then look up in the sky and you will see the Twin Towers. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam told us more than 1400 years ago that this would come. So if you can't see the tall buildings and thus recognize that you're living in the last age, akhiru zaman, something is wrong. Something is wrong. In this last age, there is a destiny for the city of Medina. And it is that subject that we address tonight. At the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, Medina occupied center stage in the world. Only once before had Islam been established in the world as a state. And that occurred with Nabi Dawood alayhi salam, and then with his son Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam. And it was known as the Holy State of Israel. And in that Holy Israel, Allah was recognized as Al-Malik. Sovereignty belonged to him. Allah was recognized Al-Akbar. Supreme authority belonged to him. The politicians don't like this at all. No. And in that city, Allah was recognized as Al-Hakam. His law is the supreme law. And his law is enforced as the supreme law. That was Holy Israel in the Holy Land, Al-Ardul Muqaddasa. And after that, only one more time, was Islam established on the earth as a state under the authority of a prophet of Allah. And that was Medina. And so Medina succeeded Jerusalem in center stage on the world stage when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam died. We knew it as the Khilafah state. The Khilafah state. A state which recognized Allah as sovereign. Recognize Allah's authority as supreme. Recognize Allah's law as the supreme law. What Allah made halal, the state enforced as halal. What Allah made haram, the state enforced as haram. So simple. And then came the death of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And strange things began to happen. And the Khilafah was taken out of Medina. You know the little oasis in the desert, agricultural town, having no significance except for goats and sheep and so on. So let's take it to Damascus, a more civilized city, a more famous city. And so the Khilafah went to Damascus. It went to Baghdad. It went to Cairo. It even went out of the Arab world into a new part of the Arab world, Andalusia, but still Arab. And then it went mysteriously so. And this history is still to be written by a historian who perhaps is not yet born, or maybe is now a baby, but who will one day write this history. The Dajjal, the false Messiah, was at work. When the Khilafah was taken, out of the Arab world, taken to a people who did not have credentials to rule over the heartland of Islam. The Ottoman Empire had many things that you don't know about, and we'll have to speak about it when we give the lecture, inshallah, I think next week, on the conquest of Constantinople in Akhirul Zaman. I think that lecture is next week, inshallah. About 100 years ago, in another 10 years from now, it will be 100 years since the transfer of power took place in Mecca after the Ottoman Turkish rule over Mecca and Medina, which lasted for almost 400 years. An Arab Spring came to the Arab world, and as usual, it was a European engineered Arab Spring, a Zionist engineered Arab Spring, which injected the virus of Arab nationalism, in consequence of which Sharif al-Hussein, the Ottoman appointed Sharif of Mecca, rebelled against the Ottoman rule in 1916. And then in 1924, when Mustafa Kemal, I don't call him Atatürk, I call him Mustafa Kemal, when Mustafa Kemal, acting in accordance with the wishes of his Zionist masters, announced the abolition of the Khilafah. An attempt was made to bring the Khilafah back to the Arab world, where it should have been, in the heartland of Islam. The Khilafah started in Medina. So Sharif al-Hussein, 7 days, or was it 4 days, either 4 or 7 days, after the Turkish Grand National Assembly announced the abolition of the Khilafah, Sharif al-Hussein, who is probably the great-grandfather of the present King of Jordan, he declared, "I am the Khalifa. I am the Khalifa. I claim the Khilafah in Mecca." Well, this was a positive move. He abolishes the Khilafah, and we say, no, you should not do that. The Khilafah is an essential institution of Islam. And so he attempts to preserve the Khilafah by establishing the Khilafah once again in the Hijaz, in Mecca. But that was not in accordance with British and Zionist planning. You see, they had first of all made an agreement with him at the time when he rebelled against the Ottomans. Lawrence of Arabia had gone into Arabia with a checkbook, sterling pounds, and paid him 7 million sterling pounds to come on our side. So if you are a client of the Anglo-American Zionist Alliance, Judeo-Christian Zionist Alliance, you can't turn against them, double A. So his claiming to be the Khalifa was not pleasing to the British, who then turned to another ally that they had, someone who didn't have the clout that Sharif Hussein had, so he couldn't ask for 7 million pounds. He was in Riyadh. His name was Abdulaziz ibn Saud. He was known as the Sultan of Najd, and he had to be content with 5,000 sterling pounds a month. And when his people, his armed force, the Ikhwan, not the Ikhwan in Egypt, when they asked him, how could you take the 5,000 pounds a month from the British? Huh? Haram. He says, no, this is jizya. This is jizya. So the British turned to another ally of theirs, who then sent his armed force against Sharif al-Hussein and defeated and conquered Mecca. In fact, they did it without any fight. Mecca surrendered. And that was in 10 years from now, that will be 100 years since that occurred. And so the regime change took place in Mecca, and 1 year later in Medina. And Mecca and Medina now come under Arab rule. Arab rule. Would the status of Mecca and Medina be restored? Would they come back to center stage? Would the Khilafah be restored? Would Abdulaziz ibn Saud, who's made an alliance with the Wahhabi movement, and I do not use the term Wahhabi in any pejorative way, no, would they restore the Khilafah? You must be making a joke. Abdulaziz ibn Saud knows very well that his masters in London would not allow him to do that. If he were to claim the Khilafah, the same thing would happen to him that happened to Sharif al-Hussein. Because the Zionists do not want the Khilafah state to survive. And now we can understand that Dajjal was at work. Dajjal wants to destroy the Khilafah, and his planning takes hundreds of years. Hundreds of years. That's why there's a historian who is going to come, who will write this history one day, but is not yet written, using the tools of analysis out of Ilmu Akhir al-Zaman, Dajjal. We now understand that the Ottoman success in taking over Constantinople and then in building that powerful Ottoman Empire and then taking over much of the Arab world over its control and then taking the Khilafah to Constantinople out of the Arab world for the first time in the history of Islam, in the history of this Ummah, the Khilafah is taken out of the Arab world. We understand that this was a preliminary step on Dajjal's path to eventually demolish the Khilafah. And that Ottoman rule, which lasted for 400 years, was meant to prepare the way for the destruction of the Khilafah. And so when Ibn Saud, Abdulaziz Ibn Saud, and I have a book on this subject, it is entitled The Caliphate, the Hijaz, and the Saudi Wahhabi Nation State. Maybe Haji Radwan will translate it into Bahasa, inshallah. We are out of stock of that book. It has to be reprinted. I wrote it 35 years ago when I was a PhD student in Geneva, and I had access to the United Nations Library in Geneva. That's where I got all this information from, which otherwise I could not access because it's destroyed. That book tells the story of how these events took place. Abdulaziz ibn Saud now has control over Makkah and Medina. What is he going to do? In that book that I just mentioned, you'll find the history of how the world of Islam responded to the abolition of the Khilafah, the destruction of the Khilafah by Mustafa Kemal. Jamiatul Azhar in Egypt was the first to respond. And they decided that their response would be a Khilafah conference, Mu'tamarul Khilafah, which they organized to take place in Cairo in 1926. I don't think you were born at that time. But Abdulaziz ibn Saud then decided to sabotage the Cairo conference. Because the Cairo conference was organized to restore the Khilafah. To restore the Khilafah. And that bothered the British a lot. So he organized a rival conference in Makkah to sabotage that. And that rival conference in Makkah, also in 1926, but on the occasion of the Hajj, that rival conference saw Mecca once again come to center stage in the affairs of the world of Islam after so many hundred years. Mecca returns to center stage in that conference which was organized in 1926 in Mecca. He organized that conference because he wanted the world of Islam to accept his rule over the Hijaz. But thank Allah that we had men, scholars of Islam from India, who attended that conference. Like Maulana Muhammad Ali Jauhar, rahimahullah. And the And when the Indian Islamic scholarship stood up and declared their position, that no, the Hijaz does not belong to you, then the rest of the conference, including the Saudi delegates, could do nothing. And so the effort failed. That was Mecca. The king decided that the conference should take place every year at the time of the Hajj. MashaAllah. What a wonderful suggestion, eh? That the whole of the world of Islam should come together at the time of the Hajj. That the affairs of the world of Islam and the affairs of the world at large may be discussed by the leaders and the scholars. What a wonderful idea by Abdulaziz ibn Saud. But because the conference said to him, no, we don't recognize you, that was it. The conference was never held again in Mecca. So Mecca now begins to recede back again, no longer occupying any position of significance. What about Medina? Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam is in Medina. What would Abdulaziz ibn Saud do about this city? When they failed in their effort to get political recognition, they decided a plan for Medina, that Medina will now become a university town. So they established the Islamic University of Medina. And this university in Medina is now charged with the task, because it's not only a Saudi state, it's a Saudi Wahhabi state. And the Wahhabis have a Protestant version of Islam. Study the Protestant movement in Europe and you'll understand much about the Wahhabi Islam. And this Wahhabi Islam, this Protestant Islam, is now going to be established in Medina in this university. Students are going to come from all over the world. And from Medina, a new version of Islam, which is the authentic Islam. Authentic Islam will now reach out to the world of Islam. And the target that you have to attack and demolish is Sufism, the Sufis. These Sufis are the ones who have destroyed Islam. They brought all kind of shirk and bid'ah and this and that and the other. And we have the task of purifying the faith and restoring the original faith. Oh, but the original faith had a spiritual heart. The original faith had men who could see with the nur of Allah. The original faith had men, you couldn't take them for a ride. No. That was the original faith. اتَّقُوا فِرَاسَةَ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّهُ يَنْظُرُ بِنُورِ اللَّهِ. So if you are going to restore the original faith in Medina, you are going to produce those scholars who will be able to see that Saudi Arabia's subservience to an alliance with the Anglo-American Zionist alliance is a betrayal of Islam. A horrendous, monstrously wicked betrayal of Islam. If you are going to produce in this university men who have the purest version of Islam, then there'll be people who have eyes with which to see. And they will ask the question, well, how come? You have control of the Hijaz, you have control of Mecca and Medina. Why are you not restoring the Khilafah? At least this much will come out of the university. But Protestant Islam has eyes and yet cannot see. Protestant Islam has ears and yet cannot hear. Protestant Islam has hearts and yet do not understand. Ulaika kal-an'am. They're just like cattle. Don't be annoyed with me for speaking the truth. If you had any integrity, then for the last 70, 80 years, you would have been raising your voice in Mecca and Medina and calling for the restoration of the Khilafah. If you had any integrity, you would have denounced the Saudi regime for their subservience to and the alliance with the wicked, the monstrously wicked Anglo-American Zionist alliance, Judeo-Christian alliance. Allah in the Quran has prohibited Muslim alliance with the Judeo-Christian alliance. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا اليهود والنصارى أولياء بعضهم أولياء بعض. Do not take such Jews and do not take such Christians, not all Jews, not all Christians. Do not take such Jews and do not take such Christians as your friends and allies, who themselves are friends and allies of each other. The Quran is referring to this Judeo-Christian Anglo-American Zionist alliance. And if you become their allies, as Saudi Arabia has done, as Kuwait has done, as Qatar has done, so many others, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. Whosoever from amongst you turn to them for friendship and alliance, you've lost your Islam. You now belong to them. And Allah does not provide guidance for a people whose trademark is wickedness. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And so the university town was dust in your eyes. The claim that this is the pure Islam was dust in your eyes, because it was Protestant Islam all the way in Medina. We now turn to our subject about the destiny of Medina in Akhir al-Zaman. And when we take up this subject, the Saudi state is not going to like it at all. Oh no. But this is the word of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And we now have the internet, we now have YouTube, which can take these words. You can't stop it. All the people of Saudi Arabia can listen now and hear what we have to say. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke and said, the hadith is narrated by Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and it is in the Sunan of Abi Dawood. He said that Umranu Bayt al-Maqdis, at that time when Jerusalem is flourishing, when Jerusalem is in center stage of the world, at that time, Kharabu Yathrib, Medina at that time, will be in a state of desolation, having no significance at all, playing absolutely no role whatsoever, not in world affairs, not in affairs of the world of Islam. Umranu Bayt al-Maqdis, Kharabu Yathrib. And then he said, Kharabu Yathrib, Khurujul Malhama. At that time, when Yathrib, meaning Medina, Yathrib is the old name, Medina, when Yathrib is in a state of desolation, at that time, the world will experience the Malhama, the great war that will make First World War and Second World War look like peanuts. That's Malhama. And then he said, now listen carefully, that Khurujul Malhama, Fathul Constantinia, that at that time when the great war takes place, at that time it will lead to the conquest of Constantinople. Today, Mustafa Kemal didn't like the name Constantinople because it's there in the hadith. So he changed the name from Constantinople to Istanbul. That's the reason why he changed it, because he doesn't want you to read this hadith. That's why. And then he said, Fathul Constantinia, Khurujud Dajjal. At that time, when Constantinople is conquered, that is a time when you experience the Khuruj of Dajjal. Now, I have another lecture coming up at the Palma Hotel. You know where the Palma is? Ampang Point. On this subject, the conquest of UIA, sorry, yes, This subject is at the university, the International Islamic University, the conquest of Constantinople in Akhiruz Zaman. I think it's July 4th,